specifically about atomic host. But let's start off with who am I? So I'm a computer engineer, went to a school in North Carolina called NC State University for computer engineering. I happened to be a glutton for punishment because I decided to get a master's as well while I was working in the Research Triangle Park area. I'm also an open source nut. The first job that I ever had was kind of introduced me to Linux and CentOS and the broader communities there. Really taught me what open source was and a little bit about how not to use open source, because we never contributed anything back, but it was amazing dealing with people in the community and realizing I could actually get features in if I contributed them. You know, the company itself didn't really take that philosophy on, but I kind of learned that myself from learning from most of the people in this room, actually. I'm also employed by Red Hat. I love Red Hat. It's a really good company, and we do adopt a lot of those philosophies that I love about open source. What I'm going to talk about a little bit before I get to Atomic Host is Project Atomic. So it's basically an umbrella project for a lot of container-related technologies. One of those at the top of the list there is Atomic Host. There's an Atomic CLI, which basically helps you do things related to containers, including manage the host. I have Atomic Registry on there. That's a little bit defunct at this point because there wasn't really an upstream that was active around that project, so we've kind of decided to go more with the OpenShift built-in registry instead of the Atomic Registry. There used to be a project called the Atomic Developer Bundle, which was basically a vagrant box that would let you easily spin up Kubernetes or OpenShift environments. I think what that team found is people didn't really like dealing with Vagrant as much, or it just wasn't as easy as some other options. So they developed a tool called MiniShift instead. So that was kind of a progression of listening to users and trying to come up with a better solution. There's a tool called Compose, which is essentially a tool that allows somebody to take an existing set of like Docker Compose files and get them up and running in Kubernetes very easily. There's also the Fedora Layered Image Build System or the CentOS Container Pipeline, which are systems that allow you to build container images based on RPM content. Adam Miller gave a talk on that yesterday about the Fedora Layered Image Build System and how we have multi-arch support there now, or we will very soon. There's also the Open Container Initiative, which we're involved in, and another thing that we are doing now is a technology called System Containers, which are pretty interesting, and I think there was a talk on that earlier today. Hope you made it. But what I really want to talk about today is Atomic Host. So I'm going to go over a few bullet points real quick, and then we'll dig into them a little bit. So what is an Atomic Host? I'm not going to go into detail now, but it's essentially a lightweight operating system. There's a section in here called "It's a tree, not a disk image." I like to sell it as Git for your operating system. It's built from RPMs. It has atomic upgrades and rollbacks, and it's essentially just a good host platform for containers. But first, before we dig into each one of those bullet points, why do you care? So essentially, for the most reason, at least initially, why you care was related to containers. So, for example, with containers, you have lower overhead, so you're able to stack more of them on a host system. And it's similar to running a process natively versus in a virtual machine. And it's kind of like a trude on steroids. So it leverages kernel namespaces to essentially get more isolation than you would with a normal trude and less isolation than you would with a VM. But there's less overhead there. But really what it's doing is using a container image as the root file system versus reusing part of what's on the host. And by using these container images with a root file system that's different than what's on the host, you essentially get what I call BYOE, or breeding your own environment. So because of the BYOE approach, you should be able to easily export your environment to somebody else. They should be able to run something and see the same things that you're seeing, if it's a problem or if it's good results. You're hoping that they're able to reproduce. So that's where we come back to atomic host, it's essentially, you know, we're able to make atomic host or a container-based OS that is a little more lightweight. So the host has less responsibility. All it needs to really do is be able to run containers and do it well. You throw in some management tools and try to remove everything else. The next thing that I had listed in the bullet points were it's kind of a tree. It's not a disk image. So like traditionally you would think, oh, create a golden image and then you deliver it to everybody. This is a little different. So like only parts of the file system are immutable. For example, users mounted as read-only, which helps prevent, you know, people from modifying software on the system. This is good from like a security perspective. A lot of people like that. But not everything's read-only. So for example, we can still edit configuration in Etsy or bar. So you can set your time zone, or you can, you know, add something to Etsy host if you want to. It wouldn't really be that useful otherwise. Another thing is multiple trees can be staged on a system. So like we could, for example, rebase between Fedora and CentOS, or Fedora 25 and 26. And all these different deployments that we have on the system, you can upgrade or roll back between them, so you can essentially revert all the state that happened since the last time you did an operation. So there's more documentation on that if you go to the OS tree docs, but we'll actually get into that a lot during the lab today. So the next bullet point I had was, it's kind of like Git for your OS. I think this is the easiest way to explain it. You know, there's obviously places where it breaks down, but I think if I say it's like Git for your OS, a lot of people can immediately say, oh, okay, that kind of makes sense. But at any time, you can essentially check what's present on the system versus what was delivered, which is kind of neat. You can see, for example, all of the config that was changed on the system. For example, on the slide right here, I run a command called os-tree-admin-config-diff, and that shows me, oh, an fs-tab file was added in Etsy, which is essentially something that was probably added by Anaconda when you installed the system. But when on the server side we created this OS tree, we didn't define an Etsy FS tab for you because we had no idea what environment your system would be in. The next example I have on there is just showing some other files that have changed, and the M means they were modified. And then the next command up there basically allows you to see exactly what changed. So the admin config diff will really only tell you if a file was added, modified, or deleted. But what if you want to see what was changed about the file? So you can do that with a diff command, and we're going to get into that in the lab. So another thing about Atomic Host, it's built from RPMs. These are the same RPMs that essentially come from Fedora and CentOS or Red Hat or whatever else that you know today. So for example, you can still run an RPM query and see what version of an RPM is installed. This might be useful for things like CVEs or, you know, knowing that a certain feature showed up in a new version of an RPM. And you can also layer in other needed RPMs if you want to. It's a relatively new feature. So we have atomic upgrades. So if you go for a little while and, you know, a new update's available for your system, you run a command called RPM OS tree upgrade. It downloads a new update on the branch that you're following, and it stages that in the background while you continue to run your system. And it also only downloads the diff from what you already have to what's in the update. So for example, if you wait 6 months before you update, you're probably going to have a much bigger update to download than if you wait 2 weeks. And it stages the deployment for next boot. This also means that if you lose power or something happens in the middle of the update, you lose network, nothing bad happens to your system because all it was doing was downloading files and copying them somewhere. But it hasn't actually staged anything for boot. It hasn't done anything that's going to affect your system yet, which is essentially the atomic part of it. At the point we do the reboot is when the actual switch to the new software happens. So basically, no software ever runs in a half-upgraded state. So after a reboot, we can run a command called RPM OS tree status, and that'll show the state of the system. From this output, you can see that we have two different versions of an OS tree that we have on the system right now. It's the pre-upgrade state, which is 25.108, and it's the one that we're currently booted into, which is the upgraded one, which is 25.113. Okay, rollbacks. So we still have two deployments on the system from the output on the previous slide. If we want to roll back, all we have to do is run rpm os tree rollback. That old deployment still there on the system. It'll stage the old deployment and revert all configuration that happened to Etsy since you ran that upgrade. So what is Atomic Host's role in all this? Basically, run containers, do it well, and manage the software on the host. And the rest is pretty much history. So I have a little slide in here called It's Not All Rainbows. This has actually gotten better over time. This is a bit of an older slide deck. But that's why I added a section called Traditionally. So traditionally, RPM OS tree or Atomic Host has been not as flexible. So like, for example, if previously you wanted to install a new RPM, we didn't have that functionality for a while. But now we can install new RPMs with technology called package layering. Another thing that's a little more inflexible than like another system that you might have experience with is you must reboot to apply an update. Well, that's why we call it atomic, right? It's the atomic part of the atomic host. But there's an experimental feature to address this as well. It's called livefs. We'll also go over that in the lab. And then one thing that I find a little bit confusing about the technology, but you know, once you learn it, it's okay, is there are quite a few different mount points and different troops that are involved with the technology, so that can be confusing sometimes. But it's kind of a necessary evil for everything that we're trying to do. All right, so that's pretty much it for the presentation. For the lab itself, what I am having people do is just go to a website called devel.dustymabe.com, and that will essentially bring up like a dev version of my blog where I have all of the sections of the lab posted. And if you just scroll on this page, oops, sorry, I didn't realize I didn't have that over there. So if you just scroll on this page, you'll see part 0, part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, and part 5. This is kind of going to be more of a self-paced thing. We can also do a little bit of a model where at a certain point in time I ask people to raise their hand and say, oh, we're done with lab 0 or part 0. And I'll run through it on the big screen. So it depends on whatever, you know, people in the room think is valuable. But typically what I end up doing is kind of letting people do a self-paced thing and then asking questions as they have problems or they, you know, have questions. But so what we'll do real quick is go ahead and click on Lab Zero. And one of the very first things in Lab Zero is basically starting up a Fedora 26 Atomic Host. And the instructions that I did right here for the lab are to add a favorite box and to bring it up using Vagrant. You don't have to do that. You can use AWS. You can spin up a kcal if you know how to provide cloud init to a kcal image with a password. But my recommendation is to use Vagrant. I also have a link to the Fedora developer portal, which will tell you how to install Vagrant on your system if you don't have it. So that's something else that you can do. And let's see. There's a few other things that I have you do in this lab part zero, which one of them is to extend the root file system. This is so that we can copy files into the atomic host and serve them, and we're also doing a bunch of rebase operations during the lab, so this will allow the root file system to be big enough for all of those things that we're going to do. And then the reason I've been having everybody download all of these files from a USB key is because there's a section called Download Lab Files Archive. Essentially what I've done with the lab is make it so that anybody can run this anywhere at any time. So in this blog post, I've asked people to please download this file, and I actually show a step where they curl that URL inside of Atomic Host in a certain directory. In our case for the lab, since a lot of you have the files on your machine, doesn't have the USB with all the files on it. Looks like I did a pretty good job there. Okay. All right. Okay, so I think I'm just going to kind of let people go at their own pace, and then we, once we get to a point where we think enough people are done with a certain particular, like, section of the lab, we can execute it all together, or we can just keep going at our own pace.
And
right, we only have like 8-10 minutes left. So if you have any questions that you want to ask before we leave, feel free to do that now. Or if you want to wrap up, you have the free ability to execute this lab at any point and share it with anybody that you might want to. So feel free to share that with people and come and ask us questions in Project Atomic, #atomic on Freenode, or atomicdevel at projectatomic.io. We'd love to have more people involved. So hope you enjoyed it. We have another like 5 minutes. Or